My grace is sufficient for you. Those words from the Lord to St. Paul in our second reading this weekend, I think, are words that we should reflect on, but also that we should seek to embrace in our own lives. That the grace of the Lord is sufficient for us. The problem, though, is for many of us, it's not what we want. We don't want God's grace, we want what we want. We want God to give us what we have prayed for in the way, in the time, and in the manner in which we prayed for it. We don't want God's grace. We don't want God to take care of things because something deep down inside of us struggles to believe that God actually has our best in mind. And you may say, Father, that's such a disappointing thing to hear on Sunday morning. That's such a pessimistic view on life. Well, it's the reality of the world in which we live. If we truly believe that God's grace was sufficient, we would live as if it was. We would act as if we have everything we will ever need, and yet, rarely do we have everything we ever want. And so we struggle to understand the concept of God's grace being enough for us. It's interesting that St. Paul went to the Lord time and time and time again, asking for this thorn to be removed from his flesh. How many times do we go to the Lord time and time again, asking for certain situations to be removed from our own midst? And imagine if I was really just struggling with some sin, and I go to the Lord and say, Lord, take this burden from me. Take this temptation away from me. Take this cross from me. And God's response was, my grace is enough. I don't know if my response would be quite as loving as St. Paul's was. And then he boasts in his weaknesses. Now, the older I've gotten, the more I've realized that weaknesses are opportunities. The weaknesses are opportunities truly for us to grow in holiness. St. Paul is trying to get us to understand and to see and to grow. Because where we are lacking, where we invite God in, he can sustain us. He will sustain us. He will give us what we need. And he can help us grow out of vice into virtue. If we listen, if we obey, if we put into practice what it is he has given to us. The problem, though, is, as the book of Ecclesiastes says, there's nothing new under the sun. We keep banging our heads against the wall generation after generation, day after day, year after year, month after month, wondering why aren't things getting any better, and yet we don't ask ourselves the question, what am I doing about it? God has given us the grace to be holy. But are we putting it into practice? You know, I understand Jesus' frustration in today's gospel. A prophet is not without honor except when he goes home. Remember the first time that I preached on this gospel as a priest was my first time preaching at Bishop McGinnis, going back to my own high school and preaching to my own teachers and preaching to my principal, preaching to my dad there and being like, oh, this is not going to go well. Jesus, when he went home, it didn't go well. It's not going to go any better for me, Lord. Please make this work. And yet I went home and I preached on that gospel because it was the gospel of the day, and it's like, seriously, this is the gospel that you chose out of all of them that you can choose in these three-year cycle. This is the one you chose? You are funny. How many times when it comes to our family do we have the burden of fraternal correction? In the sense of seeing that they are going down the wrong path, it is then our duty and our responsibility to say, hey, caution here. You might not want to go down that path. And yet, how many times does our hand get slapped when we try and correct those that we love the most? I'll never forget one time in seminary where was having a conversation with one of my sisters about something that had happened on the Grammys that year. They had this like 50 or 60 civil unions happening between gay couples at the Grammys. And the priest preached about how that was such a horrible thing. And she got upset about it. And I said, well, you realize that's the teaching of the church, right? The church doesn't believe in marriage between anyone between a man and a woman. I just don't like it, Danny. I get that. But and we kept going further and further and further, and I kind of came to the point where it's like, hey, since you're so publicly and just antagonistically going against church teaching, you might want to consider going to confession before you go to communion. Seems harmless, right? It's a great observation. Many times in life, we forget that confession isn't just a tool to keep us out of hell, but it's also a tool to help us embrace God's grace. She didn't hear the challenge to, hey, let's strive for holiness. She heard her brother that's about to be ordained as a priest just told us she was going to hell. Phone calls from the siblings like, whoa, that is not what I said. What I said was because she isn't living authentically as we're called to live, and she's obstinately against it publicly, privately, altogether, she should probably go to confession because she's kind of in this state of sin. This is what Christ is talking about when he talks about a prophet being welcome everywhere but home. It's interesting that even in the hometown of Jesus, faith was lacking. Think about that for a second. Faith was lacking in the hometown of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. I think most times when we think about Jesus' hometown, we think of this beautiful creche scene from the Nativity, and everybody's just all lovey-dovey, and we take the reality and the humanity out of the gospel many times. We forget that there was persecution going on in that time. Remember when they fled to Egypt? They did so that he wouldn't be murdered as a child. We forget of the hardships sometimes of the world in which Christ was there. And all of his family members had witnessed him preaching. They had seen the miracles that he had proclaimed. They had witnessed to these things, and yet there was a lack of faith. Even in his own apostles, Thomas, after the resurrection, said, unless I put my hands through his nail holes and in his side, I will not believe. So Jesus, of course, the next week says, here I am. Here are the holes of my hands and the hole of my side. Take, put, it'll work. And Thomas, when he saw, he believed. My Lord and my God. What was Christ's response? Blessed are those who have not seen and believed. He's talking about us. Many times in life, we don't see the visible hand of God, yet we believe because we keep coming. And sometimes we just keep coming so that we don't go to hell this week. Check. Made it to Mass. Good. Awesome. But what do we do with what we receive here? Oh, Father, when I go to church, it's so boring. Your homily's okay sometimes, and other times I fall asleep, and I don't get anything out of Mass, you know? I really don't like to go to church because can't I just have a personal relationship with God? I mean, I'm spiritual, but I'm not really religious. Is that okay? Well, no. Satan is spiritual and not religious. Satan has more faith in God than most Catholics. He knows for a fact that God exists. He just does everything that he can to get us to deny it, reject it, and not believe it. As a community of faith, we are called to not only profess our faith, which we do every time we come here on Sundays, but to actively pursue it and live it out as a community of faith. But why can't I just watch it online, Father? I mean, when COVID happened, we all went to online watching it. Why can't we just stay at home and watch it from the comfort of our homes? Well, because religion takes sacrifice. But also, watching online, though it is okay-ish, is not the same as being here present. Watching on TV is not actively, consciously participating in the liturgy. Now, if you're sick, if you're traveling, dispensation, yes, it's there. But if you can make it to Walmart, if you can make it to the movie theaters, if you can make it to Ackley Park to watch fireworks, if you can make it to Friends to go have a beer, you can make it to Mass. And if not, that's where our priorities come in. Oh, but Father, I'm so sick, and I just can't be within anybody. I can't be close to anybody. Sit in the vestibule. Sit in the cry room. Sit in the confessional. We have three different places that are secluded here at Mass so that you can be here present. Show me an excuse. I can find you a solution. Because we all have them, and I've made most of them in my life. God's grace is enough to manage any obstacle you face, if you truly believe in faith that God is who He says He is. That when the bread and wine become truly the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Christ, God lowers Himself to not only becoming human, but offering Himself for you and for me in a tangible way so that we can truly experience Christ in our midst in a very real way. Not in a tangential way, not in a relational way, but Christ is truly present in the Eucharist. And our role in the Mass, ironically, isn't to receive, but is to give honor, to give due deference, to give worship, to give praise and glory to God for every way that He's blessed us in our lives every single day of the week. Oh, Father, God doesn't bless me. Really? He may not give you what you want, but I guarantee you are blessed by God. The fact that we can gather here without any fear of persecution, we're going to be ostracized in the community. Well, welcome to Western Oklahoma being a Catholic. But beyond that, I had someone contact me 3 weeks ago on social media and say, Father, I live in a country where it is a crime to be a Christian. It is a crime to be baptized. And my local church will not baptize my son because they were afraid if this is known that he is baptized, that they will be arrested and beheaded. So they asked, is it okay, is it permissible for me to baptize my son? And I sat there and thought and prayed, and it's like, thank you, Lord, for not allowing me to have to deal with this every day. You know, we don't think about the ways that we've been blessed here in the United States for religious freedom. Yes, there are certain things we can't do, but there are so many things we can do as Catholics, as Christians, and yet the things that we can do, we don't do. We don't grow in our faith. We don't learn what it means for us to truly be the hands and feet of Christ. You know, when I go to a new person in the parish that I want to be a catechist, I go to them and I say, hey, what do you think about teaching this year? I don't know, Father. I mean, I can't. Well, why can't you? Well, my last catechesis class, I was in like confirmation. That was like 20, 30, 40 years ago, and I just don't feel comfortable in my faith to like try and share it with the kids. Okay, well, we've got these adult classes on Wednesday night. Do you want to come to those? Yeah, see, I don't know. I mean, I don't know if I can really grow in my own faith, because then you're going to ask me to teach. You're right, I will. But that is what we're called to do. We are called to learn and grow personally so we can learn and grow communally. One of the best blessings that we have here at the parish is that as soon as I typically ask for more catechists, the last 2 years, we sent out a flock note. Within 30 minutes, all of our classes have been covered. That is a great blessing. 95% of our parishes in the Archdiocese do not have that blessing, so thank you. Thank you for those who have taught for 20, 30, 40 plus years. Thank you for who are still coming as adults and bringing your kids and your grandkids. Because it's important for us as a community of faith to be here as a family of faith. That when you aren't here, it's noticed. You guys may not notice each other being missing because sometimes you go to the 5 o'clock mass or sometimes you go to Sayer, but I see everyone every weekend. And I know who's not here, and I know who is here. I don't take roll, but in my head, it's like, oh, that section's a little emptier than normal, or that section's a little fuller than normal. Who's actually here today? What happened? In a good way. That as members of the faith community, we are called to practice our faith so that grace can abound and so that great things can happen. Christ asked the question in the gospel, when the Son of Man returns, will he see people of faith? My hope is yes. My hope is that I'm counted among those that he sees in faith, and that so too are all of you present here. But it takes us engaging in more than just showing up, but in consciously, actively participating. You know, last night I did a minor thought experiment at the end of Mass that nobody knew about, so it was even more fun. I looked around, how many times have I talked about making a joyful noise to the Lord, and how we have the books, we have the music sheets, so we can all at least fake like we're, pretend like we're actually participating, right? And I looked, we had 165 people at Mass last night. 19 people had a book open for the recessional. 19 out of 165, not including Celia and Kathy in the choir. There's 180 to 190 of us here this morning. Participate. When I say the Lord be with you,
and with your spirit,
or when we profess our faith, do we profess our faith? I believe in one God.
I believe in one God, the Father, Almighty, Creator, heaven and earth.
It's like going to like the pre-Vatican II rosaries before Mass. Our Father, who art in heaven, is it an auction? Are we auctioning off Jesus and Mary? No! We are called to actively participate and to understand as people of faith that God is blessing us in our lives. And to act and respond as if it actually makes a difference. You know, many times we look at the weaknesses we have in life as obstacles. But St. Paul today shows us a different way. Growing up, I got picked on a lot. I got bullied a lot. And a lot of it was because I was shorter. I was a sweatpants kid in class. And then I got fat. And then I got bald. Really, Lord? And so I talk a couple times a year about how I'm a short, fat, bald guy and I can't do anything about it. And in that, I begin to realize that if I make fun of myself, nobody else really wants to. Kind of in the same way that when St. Paul boasts of his weaknesses, they no longer are weaknesses, but they can become strengths. One of my biggest weaknesses as a human being and as a priest is that I'm a people pleaser. That sucks as a pastor. Be completely honest. Being a people pleaser as a pastor is tough because I take everything personally, even if it's not meant to be personal. Being a people pleaser as a priest, anything that I say and I see people respond differently, oh, what did I do this time? Everything is always critiqued and criticized. Even last week, I thought someone was mad at me because I said we couldn't do something during Mass. Come to find out, it was all in my head. That's how it is most times. But sometimes, as a priest, no matter what I do, someone is not going to agree with my decision, and someone's going to be mad, and someone's going to take offense at me. That's never my goal. My goal is always to do what I think is best for our community of faith, and sometimes that means opening my mouth and inserting my foot. That's a struggle of having a pastor that has ADHD and is an extrovert. Sorry. But no, I never do anything intentionally to piss off anybody, believe it or not. My goal is to let you know that God loves you, but also to call you to task, to literally practice your faith beyond it hurting. And when you fall, to help you get back up through the sacraments. That's the sacrament of reconciliation is all about. You know, I talk with many of my brother priests about the confessional, and some parishes have lines out the door. Some parishes, you may have someone once a month go to confession, like one person a month for the whole parish. Here we've grown. It's beautiful to see when I have to come back at the end of adoration on Fridays to hear more confessions. And I've been in the confessional the whole time, or on Saturdays where the confessional from 3:30 to 4:30 is jam-packed until 4:45. That brings me joy because it means we're on the right path. I'm not giving you license to sin. I'm just saying you are sinners and so am I. And as such, we are called to reconcile our relationship with God so that His grace can truly lead us to living out actively our faith. Because as members of this community of faith, we are meant to believe and to strive for holiness. Because remember what Christ told us. He is the way, He is the truth, and He is the life. May we not just profess that with our lips, but truly seek to grow in understanding of that so that we can authentically live it with our lives.